If you're brand new to stable diffusion, you might be at a loss on where to start. Your first attempts might not be as impressive as someone with a lot of experience. But don't worry, you'll get there in no time. This video will serve as a quick start guide to someone who's brand new to stable diffusion. I'm going to assume that you already have stable diffusion up and running and that you follow the guide like the Voldy guide or just installed it by yourself and figured it out. Now, I don't know what model you're starting with. You may be starting with Stability AI's mainline stable diffusion. You might be starting with one of the popular models that someone recommended. Whatever the case, it's going to be important to find a good model first and foremost. Now, I can't make a recommendation that won't be outdated eventually, but right now I'm using the Based66 model by Anonymous M on Hugging Face. If your images are coming out lackluster, it might just be the model, simple as that. Now, the first thing people usually become painfully aware of is VRAM management. No matter how big your graphics card is, you're gonna run out of VRAM if you make an image that's way too big. So you might be wondering, how do people get their images so large when I have trouble making anything over, like, 1024 by 1024? Now, it just so happens that I'm doing a lot of other stuff with my computer at the moment, like recording this, so my baseline VRAM usage is pretty high. But watch what happens when I generate something pretty reasonable size, 512 by 768. Now watch what happens when I use HiResFix to get a moderate resolution increase of just 1.5 times bigger, so 768 by 1152. You can see where it hits points where it gets maybe a little bit worrisome. If I went much higher than this, I would definitely run out. So what's the trick to doing something bigger? Well, the secret is upscaling. And there are a couple different upscaling methods. One is SD Ultimate Upscale, and another is Tiled Diffusion, aka Multi-Diffusion. And both of these extensions work by upscaling your image in chunks, and then stitching the image back together, so that you can make an image whatever size you want, as long as you're willing to wait for the process to finish. You might also be wondering, like, what's the point of big images? Most of these are just going to be posted somewhere, someone's going to look at them for 5 minutes, and it's going to be thrown away. Why does everything need to be super big anyway? Well, upscaling is not quite like blowing up the image in Photoshop. It's actually adding in more detail. So even if you're planning on downscaling it a little bit, it can be advantageous to upscale it just to get the fine detail in the eyes and face and such. I'm going to show you multi-diffusion today, but if you want to use Ultimate Upscale, that's pretty good too. It works similarly. Installing it is really easy. All you have to do is go to the Extensions tab, click the Available, and load from the default URL, and multi-diffusion will be in there. Mine's already installed here, so I'm not going to go over the install step, but let's go over how to use it. So I've got my starting image here. I've already generated it using HiResFix. You can actually skip HiResFix if that's taking up too much VRAM for you. It's just going to take more time to upscale it from a lower resolution. All we got to do is click Send to Image, then go down to the Tiled Diffusion section, and click Enable Tiled Diffusion. Now, for it to upscale, you're going to have to pick an upscaler. If it has none, it's not going to upscale anything for you. And then you just upscale by the amount. I chose 1.5. When you're upscaling with the Esergan upscalers, like the anime one that I'm using right now, you want to make sure that you have a low denoising strength so that it doesn't change the image too much while it's upscaling. If the denoising strength is too high, you'll get weird results and tiling artifacts. That's going to take a couple minutes to run, but while that's going, I'm going to go ahead and show you another thing, which is the config file. This is the uiconfig.json file that's in the Stable Diffusion folder, and this file tells your web UI what to use when you first load the page, so the defaults. And I'm going to go ahead and scroll down here. There's different entries for the different tabs, the image to image, text to image. But here's the entry for the multi-diffusion section and what upscaler it uses by default and how much it upscales by default. So I put this in the config file so that I don't have to mess with it every time I load Stable Diffusion. It just has the settings I want already. Go back up to the top here. This is the text to image tab, and I have stuff in there for the default negative prompt, and you can put in a default positive prompt. I've got the resolution different from 512 by 512. So really handy to change this config file to save you some work every time you load the page up. All right, let's take a look at the upscaling process again. I have not sped this up at all, just so that I can show you how long it takes to upscale one of these images. This really is the final step that you want to do after you've made any modifications to the image, just because it takes so much time. But if you look at the VRAM usage, again, it's pretty steady, and it'll be the same no matter how large you upscale it to. It's just going to take more time for bigger images. But that's pretty much all I have to show you for upscaling. Just one last thing to note is that when you send it to image to do the upscaling step, you can tweak the prompt, and that will show up in the upscaled image. So it's a nice opportunity to, once you have something that you like, to just apply slight tweaks of maybe the style or something like that. Okay, now that that's done, I'm going to just show you some tips for prompting. And this is going to depend on your model, but most of the anime-focused models behave the same way. A lot of them were trained on Danbaru tags and the like. So if you're looking for something specific, like an article of clothing or a pose or something, you can browse Danbaru for those tags and then use them in your prompt. And in fact, there's an extension that helps you with this, and that's the autocomplete extension. I highly recommend using this. It helps you with your prompts a lot. Okay, the next thing I want to show you is XYZ plot. This is immensely useful when you need to explore the effects of different tags and the combination that they have on each other. To use this, just scroll down to the bottom. In the scripts dropdown, just select XYZ plot, and then type in the parameters that you want to use. You can plot really any parameter. So if you want to see what the different effect the number of steps have, the config scale, different words in your prompt, even different models on the same prompt, XYZ plot is your friend. And in fact, I'm going to use XYZ plot to demonstrate this next feature to you, which is prompt editing. This feature allows you to swap out the prompt in the middle of the generation. So you might already be familiar with things like the strength, which lets you choose the emphasis of a certain tag. But if you want to swap out one tag altogether with another one, say halfway through, this is the way to do it. So to use this, you just use the colon to separate the tag you want to start with, the tag you want to end with, and then when you want to substitute it. You can use an integer to indicate the step number to switch at, or you can use a fractional number to indicate the percentage of the way through the prompt at which to substitute. And on a related note, we have alternating words. You can use the vertical bar character to alternate between different words every step. And it will alternate for as many different ones that you have in there. So one cool way to use this is to tweak the eye color a little bit. You can kind of get it to fight between different eye colors or glowing eyes or things like that. It's just an underrated feature to be aware of. And the last thing I want to cover today is ControlNet. Now, I'm not going to go over all of the stuff about ControlNet. I'm just going to make you aware of it and show you just how easy it is to get started with it. Now, you're going to have to follow the instructions for setting up ControlNet. It's a little bit more involved than some of the other add-ons. you have to download some extra models, but at the end of the day, it's not that hard. Once you have it set up, using it is pretty easy. I'll just show you on an example here using the anime line art section of it. You can do all kinds of other things, but this one's an easy way to get started. So I've loaded up my source image, which is just a screenshot from a manga panel, and I'm going to give it just a rough guide. I'm going to tell it the hair color to put in and the eyes to put in, and really not much else. I'm going to use all of the default settings for this. And all things considered, this is not a bad start. This will allow you to use really any reference image that you want, so you can have fine control over what you generate. But that's about all I had to go over today. I'm really just scratching the surface with this stuff. There is so much more to learn about this, but hopefully if you're brand new, now you know a few tricks that can help you get started. I'm always willing to answer questions, so just hit me up. But thank you for watching. I hope you learned something, and have a nice day.